Nearly 90% of Americans eat meat as a part of their diet. But earlier this year, the Agriculture Department approved production of what's known as cultivated meat, that is chicken grown in a lab. That approval clears the way for companies to begin selling poultry produced from animal cells rather than animals bred in factory farms and killed. William Brangham gives us a taste of what the future could hold.
We put a little allium glaze on it, which is just an onion garlic reduction. Just give it a little color and some flavor on the outside.
At the Good Meat plant in Alameda, California, Chef Nate Park is putting the finishing touches on a dish that is seemingly pulled right out of science fiction.
A lot of people don't know what this is, so there's a tendency to maybe back away because they don't know what it is. But I think once they understand what it is and that it's just chicken and that it's delicious, it'll be very easy for everyone to get on board.
Getting people comfortable with the idea of cultivated chicken is at the heart of operations here at Good Meat. It's one of two companies now federally approved to make it.
We want to slice it in front of you. We want you to see what it is that you're going to get on the plate.
Grilled, sliced, and served with heirloom beans and a sweet potato puree.
If you had said nothing about this, I would just think this was a lovely meal.
Oh, thank you.
It tastes, as the saying goes, like chicken.
It's chicken.
And delicious.
Thank you.
But long before I enjoyed it for lunch today, that chicken meat could only be seen here, inside this bioprocessing lab, as tiny microscopic stem cells. They're all taken from real chickens, without harming them. The cells are then constantly stirred, kept warm, and nourished so that they'll multiply inside these massive bioreactors. It's all part of a lengthy process designed to mirror how actual animals grow.
Cultivated meat has been talked about for over 100 years.
Josh Tetrick is the co-founder and CEO of Eat Just, which operates Good Meat.
What is the rationale for cultivated meat?
First and foremost, we just got to accept people love meat. And it's difficult, really difficult, to get people to stop eating meat and choose beans or some other plant-based source, which would be better for them. So how do you get at that? And I think the answer is you make real meat in exactly the same taste and texture that people are used to, but you make it in a way that doesn't require billions of animals. You just can't feed the world without the billions of animals, because each animal has to be slaughtered.
Global food production is responsible for roughly a third of all the man-made greenhouse gases that are dangerously heating the planet. And meat production is the major driver of that impact, with the majority of the world's croplands and forests being used to grow food for the animals we then eat.
If we're going to solve the climate problem, we definitely need to move from fossil fuels to renewable energy. And we also definitely need to move from intensive animal farming that is eating up a third of our planet today to an entirely different approach.
But not everyone is sold on this new approach.
We can't just take it as a given that cultured meat is good for the environment.
Ned Spang is an associate professor at the University of California, Davis, who studies the links between food and the environment. He says while no animals are being slaughtered, a recent report he co-authored about cultured meat indicates it's not nearly as green as many would hope.
Along the lines of climate emissions or energy use, we found that cultivated meat might actually have more of an impact than the conventional agriculture.
And how is that possible?
Well, the major driver is that these are still animal cells, so they still need to eat food. And basically, just as a cow needs to eat some grass or corn to grow and grow muscle mass, we need to feed the cells. And so we need to feed them glucose for energy and amino acids to build proteins. And it takes a lot of resources to actually make the food to grow these cells to create the cultivated meat.
But Tetrick argues that as the technology improves, cultivated meat has the potential to pollute much less and consume far less land and water than conventional meat. And he argues our current approach, from its cruelty to animals to its environmental impacts, has to change.
We're eating food every day that no one would be proud of if they actually engaged with it.
Several companies have come to market with plant-based meat substitutes, like Beyond Meat or Impossible Burgers, but cultivated meat will likely be a tougher sell. A recent poll from the Associated Press found that half of adults in the U.S. say they would be unlikely to try it, with many citing that it sounded weird.
We found the most effective way to move someone from this is kind of weird to all right, I'm down with it, is to put it on a plate, get them hanging out with their friends, and have them eat the chicken. And then a bit about midway through it, they're like, all right, this is just chicken.
We marinated overnight in an anticucho sauce.
So far, only a few restaurants in the U.S. have actually served cultivated chicken, including China Chilcano in Washington, D.C.
Take it right like this.
Yes, don't be afraid to get a little messy, don't worry.
That is delicious.
It's owned by world-famous chef Jose Andres. And here, head chef Daniel Lugo prepares it as a traditional Peruvian street food.
So when Jose first came to you and said, we'd like to try cooking with this unique type of chicken, what was your reaction?
Well, at first I was super excited and curious. And to be honest, once I tried it, I was super surprised and actually liked it.
But getting cultivated meat both into more restaurants and eventually into grocery stores won't be easy. Good Meat is reportedly looking for ways to cut surging production costs. The company had aimed to eventually produce up to 30 million pounds of meat annually.
Yeah, we are nowhere near the scalability to actually make a dent in this problem. And that was exactly the same way for solar energy 30 years ago. And we were in exactly the same position for electric cars 20 years ago. And if you're ultimately going to shift the system, best to start now, because it's going to be a many, many decade long, very, very hard, uncertain problem to solve.
It's a problem now being tested and tasted in labs like this one. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm William Brangham in Alameda, California.